He's written about Audubon. He's written about Carlton Gattachek, which is about the deadly feast, which is about prion diseases. The Donner Party, 4 novels, only one is in print, I heard. The Holocaust. He just finished a book on the Spanish Civil War. And so he's just is one of these people that has this ability to pull out amazing topics. Ginger is a clinical psychologist, and she worked with Lonnie. She did her PhD on bringing Lonnie's qualitative study into a quantitative analysis, which really helped him, I believe. So Lonnie Athens, Dick called him a rugged genius. And I found a little thing on the web about when Dick's book came out, Why They Kill. And Lonnie said, he was really amazed that a book was being written about him. And he said, it's like being outside with your clothes off. In fact, the night after the book came out, he had a dream that he had been invited to a conference as a speaker because of the book. He steps outside of his hotel room to pick up a newspaper, and he's only wearing his boxer shorts. And the door locks behind him. So Lonnie's quite a character, and you'll hear more about him tonight. A little bit on Dick Rhodes, and he's 27 books, right? Not 25, 27 books. Pulitzer Prize. The book that he wrote that is about tonight is called Why They Kill, and it talks about Lonnie's, and it was written in 98, I believe. 98? Yeah. So it's a while back, and I was asking him tonight at dinner whether they had moved it forward to the Iraq, and it's the Lonnie's typology that you'll hear about tonight is actually very much alive today in our military, and what's happening in Iraq and Afghanistan and in Syria. So numerous awards. I won't go into all that because he's won all these awards and he teaches and talks. Ginger is delightful. She's a clinical psychologist. She works with trauma patients. She works with people that are survivors of, you know, terrible violence. She teaches at the San Francisco Psychotherapy Research Group. She's got her PhD from the University of Connecticut in psychology. And she works with political asylum people from 100 different countries through the years. So both of them have a first-hand view of violence, and they're going to tell us tonight about why it happens, what turns normal people, normal kids, into violent people. So come up.
Steven Pinker, the Harvard psychologist, is only the most recent scholar to discover that violence levels in the West have declined dramatically over the past 500 years. And let me just say at the outset, we're going to be speaking tonight about private violence, about person-to-person violence. We're not going to be speaking much or any about the violence in war, or the kind of violence that some scholars call structural violence, the kind that's built into societies according to the way resources are distributed. So we're talking about people killing each other, people having fights, people robbing and beating each other, child abuse, that kind of violence. And it has declined dramatically across the last 500 years. 14th century London, the homicide rate was 52 per 100,000. Which is comparable to some of the worst of our inner cities. Today in the whole United Kingdom, it's 1 per 100,000. You can see the other numbers. Stockholm, 42.5. Sweden today, 0.7. And in the United States, which we tend to think of as a fairly violent country, and it is somewhat more violent than Western Europe, 4.7 per 100,000, down from about 10.6 in 1980, when there was a lot more violence going on because the crack epidemic, drug dealers were basically cleaning out their territories and feuding with each other. Why? Well, I think Mr. Pinker would have us think that we all became more humane. You only have to look at the 20th century and its wars to question that argument. But what is certainly true is that people over these last five centuries, as governments centralized, as kings and then nation states took control of violence, common people acquired access to courts of law. I was intrigued to look at 16th century Finland, where they happened to keep particularly good records of homicides because the homicide was considered a kind of lese majeste against the king, and therefore the king got all the worldly goods of the convicted murderer, so they kept good records. 80% of the homicides in that place at that time evolved from boundary disputes, something that we would rarely see as a cause for homicide today. Access to courts of law, then. At the same time, and paralleling that, and I don't know which was the chicken and which was the egg, but child-rearing practices changed progressively away from seriously violently dominating children toward treating them with less violence. A case that I found that was fascinating was the Dauphin Louis XIII of France, whose father had him whipped every morning when he arose from bed for the sin of pride. In other words, he began a process of violent domination, which presumably was to prepare this boy to be a king prepared to use violence himself, as kings did personally and directly at that time. There was a physician who was assigned by the court to take care of this boy, the most valuable child in France, who was with him day in and day out, night in and night out, throughout his childhood, and who kept an absolutely extraordinary record, which is still languishing in some library in France, untranscribed from the 16th century French, unfortunately, but pieces of it have been brought forward. And it's fascinating to see that his mother, influenced by her religious advisors, made a point of seeing to it that her son was not whipped every morning when the king was out of town, but only when the boy had misbehaved. So already there was this beginning of a transition, even in the most valuable child in France. The changes that came really had very little to do with policing, which we tend to think of as the source of protection against violence in our society, rather than the fact that law is available instead. But the Bobbies of London were only constituted as an organization in 1829, by which time the homicide rate in England had dropped down nearly to its modern low of 1 point something. This raises another question that I think, a lot of us haven't been very clear about. It has become, I would say, fashionable, maybe out of a kind of desperation about how to understand violence, to think of violence, personal violence today, as mental illness. We'll talk about that a little more later, but I would just point out that we authorize certain kinds of violence, and they are not only accepted legally, but even celebrated. Thank you for your service. For people who are designated in our society to use violence to protect themselves and the rest of us, that's good violence. And as its characteristics, there are, Here we are. Authorized professionals in a society that's full of specialists. We have specialists in violence. They are our police and our military. They're taught and socialized to use violence. And as you'll see, the way soldiers and police are prepared to be violent defensively corresponds to the way people are taught and socialized informally to use violence, except they go another step farther to violence that is not legal. But our police and our military do use lethal violence in our behalf. And we keep track of it. And we ask them to contain it at the level of defensive violence. And indeed, police officers, soldiers who use violence against people who are not threatening them or us are by definition breaking the law and are using violence in a criminal capacity. But we don't consider police and military insane or somehow disordered. We consider them to be trained to do something that we need to have them do. Whereas violent criminals who use violence beyond the limits of the law nevertheless have rules that they follow. They're just a different set of rules. Athens, one of the people we're going to be talking about, calls them archaic rules. And they certainly do represent the kind of violence that was commonplace everywhere in the years before government centralized, when basically everyone had to protect themselves and settle their disputes without access to some formal kind of adjudication. We now, most of us who are not violent and aren't socialized to be violent, do the same things basically that violent people do in confronting disputes, but we're not prepared to use violence. We have all these other ways, and I've listed a few of them here, that we use instead of going to violence, instead of hitting someone over the head. And most of all, legal negotiation and private negotiation, but also all these other ways, gossiping and shunning, avoiding divorce. These are all ways that people settle disputes without using physical violence. So today in the United States, although the homicide rate, as I said, is 4.7 per 100,000 nationally as of 2012, it's actually gone down a bit since then. There are still pockets of violence in the country that disturb us, worry us, give us reason to be concerned. Homicides in New Orleans, forcible rapes, this huge number of aggravated assaults indicate that we still live in a society that certainly has not completely resolved the problem of how to prepare people to live in a society peaceably rather than using physical violence to get what they want, to get their way, to settle disputes. We're going to be talking about a model of violence development that was developed by a really fascinating man named Lonnie Athens, who was a Berkeley PhD criminologist, professor of criminology at Seton Hall University in South Orange, New Jersey. I wrote a book about Lonnie's work because it intrigued me so much. It seemed, as it does to anyone who's had personal experience with violence, prima facie to make sense. Lonnie's approach to his research was not statistical, was not correlational. He used the methodology of medicine, the methodology medicine uses in tracking down the causes of diseases, which is to find people who have the disease or the condition, and then to see what they all, 100% of the sample, have in common. Athens did that by interviewing about 100 violent criminals incarcerated in prisons around the United States at an average length of interview of 10 hours each, really a major piece of work. He started out with the crime of record so that he could ascertain their veracity. If they lied to him, they didn't know he'd seen their records. If they lied to him about their crime of record, he threw out the interview. He assumed that they might lie to him about other aspects of their previous violent experiences. I mention this because when Joyce Carol Oates, that expert in violence, reviewed my book in the New York Times, she dismissed Athens' work because, of course, those criminals just bullshitted, just told him stories. She evidently didn't read the book very closely. He asked these men and women, one by one, to start with the crime of record and then talk them back through all of their major violent social experiences as far back as they could remember. And with the younger people he interviewed, they could remember all the way back to their first major violent performance at the age, typically for males, of 12 to 14 years of age. For Mike Tyson, in Mike's memoirs, it was age 11 when he remembered really beating someone up who had just torn the head off of one of his pigeons that he raised. When he had these narratives, he laid them all out and looked at them to see what 100% of his sample had in common. And then as a kind of test, he looked for people who were not violent, who indeed had been in violent situations and had not used violence. And in particular, he looked at a battered women in a battered women's shelter. He found that all of them had been through some of the stages of violent socialization that he had identified with his violent criminals, but only one of them had actually completed violent socialization, and she happened to have murdered her batterer. He wrote a book about this subject and laid out the model that he had developed, which is still in print. You can read it if you want to. The Creation of Dangerous Violent Criminals. A few other things to say before Ginger describes Athens' model to you. Violence versus aggression. Aggression is the term that's typically used in describing the kind of experiences that children have in watching what's called violent television. And that's used in the laboratory research that attempts to identify some increase in violence on the part of such children who watch Saturday morning cartoons. So it's important to know that the two are not the same. Aggression and violence are two different aspects of behavior. We actually admire aggression in many social contexts, such as football, business, and that said, let me turn the podium over to Ginger.
Thanks. Hi. Before I get into the model, I want to say a couple of things about the model. When Richard made the acquaintance of Lonnie and wrote his book, Why They Kill, I was in the middle of returning to get my PhD in clinical psychology and looking for a thesis and dissertation subject. And because of my particular background, this was of interest to me. So I took Lonnie's actual interviews and decided to create a test, a measure, and look to see if it could actually hold up, if the parts of this particular model could hold up. And eventually created a measure, tested it against a group of men in prison and with a control group of college males, and did some statistical analyses through about three different studies, and it held up. Although when I told Lonnie I was intending on doing that at the beginning, he cautioned me that I shouldn't throw my dissertation down the toilet. So, but fortunately, it all seemed to work out. But a couple of things to mention before getting into the model, and one is this idea about violence and aggression. Even in the scientific literature, those terms are often conflated, and they really need to be considered separate. We're talking about violence, and violence is an act. Aggression is an attitude, and it's an attitude we celebrate in many cases. You know, aggressive people on Wall Street, they're celebrated. Aggressive people out on the football field, they're celebrated. But an aggression is not an act. Violence is an act. The other thing that I think bears mention before we get into it is the question about violence and mental illness. There have been several high-profile cases in the past couple of years where the shooters have been clearly mentally ill. All of the studies, nearly all of the studies, many, many, many studies support the fact that people with mental illness are no more likely to be violent than people without mental illness. The numbers just don't support the fact that there's much difference. If you add substance abuse into either of those populations, the numbers go up. So substances definitely lower inhibitions and make people able to behave in ways they would otherwise more easily. But just because someone uses substance abuse, just because someone is mentally ill, doesn't mean they're violent. And the question about that, in my mind, is why are some groups violent? Why are some mentally ill people violent? Why are others not? You know, why are some people who've been abused as children violent and others are not? And the violent socialization model gets at some aspects that clarify the differences in those groups. Violent socialization has four parts to it. It is distinct experiences that people have in their life, not just the sort of every ordinary things, but really influential events that happen in people's lives. Most commonly, it happens during childhood, but not always. Military service, training for specialized police, you know, it can happen later in our lives. Athens research found that among violent criminals, that the males were often fully violently socialized by the age of 14, females somewhat older. And I'll talk a little bit about reasons why that might be. You know, as I talk about the model, my hunch is that there's several people in here it'll resonate with, aspects of it, at least aspects with it. Many of us experience aspects of this kind of socialization. The first stage is called brutalization, and there's three parts to this stage, but the common element to the whole first stage of brutalization is harsh treatment by someone in your primary group, and a primary group being a member of your family, a clique, a gang, but an close, intimate group that you have contact with on a regular basis. It may or it may not be what we would call child abuse. You know, child abuse is a normative term, and we don't even really agree on the subject. If you listen to how families define it, we've had a national discussion about it recently with the football player who beat his child with a switch. This football player didn't believe that that was child abuse. Clearly, other people felt that that was child abuse. State by state, there's a question about when you cross that line between discipline and child abuse. So child abuse is not something we easily agree about. But brutalization, this first stage in the violent socialization model, it can happen inside the family, outside the family. So clearly, it's not even the same thing as child abuse. So I mentioned that brutalization has three parts to it: violent subjugation, personal horrification, and violent coaching. This first stage is an experience that people have. They don't have a choice in having this experience. And it's a very important aspect of understanding the four-stage model, because at this point, this is a traumatic experience that someone doesn't choose to have. Later on, there are choices that people make. But in the beginning, this is purely an experience that happens. And I'll call him the novice, the person learning to use violence, and I'll also refer to him as a he. More males than females are violent in our country. Although it's a very interesting group, the number of men I've talked to who were brutalized by their mothers. So, you know, there's an interesting group out there. But this novice in violent subjugation is forced to submit to the control of a credible violent figure, and that violent figure is in their primary group. You know, the classic example is what we would, many of us would agree is child abuse. And not the novice, it doesn't even have to be axed. They don't even have to be beaten. They don't even have to be controlled in that way. If the authority figure is a credibly violent person, threats are enough. But we've talked a little bit about military service. A drill sergeant is not allowed to beat up on a recruit, but they threaten the hell out of them, and the recruits believe it because they know the sergeant could put it into force if they wanted to. So threats can be enough. And kids who are living with someone who is a violent person maybe brutalizes one of the children in the house, the other child is not physically beaten, but that is just as frightening for them, seeing that the other person is, because they know that it could happen to them. The other aspect of brutalization is having it happen to someone you love and not being able to do anything about it. And that's that personal horrification, that there's someone you love, they're being brutalized, you can't do anything about it. The typical combination is two siblings, one of whom's being beaten, both are actually being beaten, and them not being able to help each other. And not wanting to, I mean, the deep dark secret that I've heard people tell me before is the guilt and shame they have at not wanting to do it because they knew it would put them at risk. So the humiliation, the shame, the rage that starts to build in young people, in four-year-olds, in six-year-olds, in eight-year-olds, starts to build in them with this experience of being dominated by this violent person and not being able to do anything about it or choosing not to do anything about it with someone they love. The third aspect of this, and all three of these parts comprise this stage one, is violent coaching. And this is the crucial part. And there have been many, many people who have been exposed to this model who say this is the missing piece, really, want the missing piece that they don't see in other models. And that is that a credible, credibly violent figure, and it doesn't have to be in your primary group, someone you know, and often it's more than one person over a period of time, they communicate to that novice not how to take action into their own hands, but why. And the why is it's your personal responsibility. If you are going to ever be out of this situation, it's because you're going to do something about it. And you know, that kind of coaching happens on all sorts of levels. It commonly happens in households where some kid comes home crying and dad or mom says, you go back and beat the heck out of that kid. You know, don't come in here crying to me. Go back there and take care of it yourself. You know, that's one of its benign sort of boys will be boys, get out there, stand up for yourself. What's the matter? Don't you want to be a real man? You know, that kind of, not benign by my books, but it happens in a lot of households. So that, from that stage all the way to the violent coach that brags about, another way of coaching a credibly violent figure is to brag about what I do, and this is what I would have done, and this is what I've done in the past. And it's that person who is communicating to that novice who feels humiliated and full of rage that this is happening to him and he can't protect someone, some loved one, hearing that again and again and again, that ultimately it's going to be his responsibility to do something about it. So this stage one, as I said, all three parts have to be experienced. It could happen all at once, like military training. It could happen over time. It's pretty common that the the two pieces happen together, you know, the being dominated and having someone you love to be dominated. It can be a parallel experience in one family. Violent coaching, the coaching, you can have multiple coaches over time, so that can happen over a period of time. Before that novice is ready to take their first violent step, they might need some size. You know, they might need to get up to a certain size. Bill Clinton wrote in one of his memoirs about listening for years to his mother being beaten by his stepfather and not being able to do anything about it until he was 15. And he confronted the guy and he said, "You're never going to beat my mother again." So, you know, at some point, it takes a big enough size and girth. I don't know how many people have thrown a punch in here, but the first time that you do it, you take risk. You know, there's a big risk. You could be hurt worse. You know, it could backfire on you. It could not work. So it can take a while. But again, that first stage, a really important thing to remember is it is not a choice. That happens. And subsequently, there are some choices. But that at the end of that first stage, the novice has got a really troubled internal self. This humiliation and rage and this question about whether he's ever going to be able to end this. And then there comes a point when the novice clicks with what the coach said and finds it credible that they could protect themselves. And he makes this decision, Lonnie Athens calls it a mitigated violent resolution, that the next time that bully approaches him, he's going to do something about it. He's going to do whatever it takes to try to do something about it. And that this means that if he's seriously threatened, and if he thinks he has a chance to succeed, he will use serious violence. So again, unlike the first stage, this stage, the brutalization stage, this is a choice. And the desire is to win a victory. So with that mitigated resolution, the novice starts to experiment with violence. And the novice can try out several different ways with varying kinds of outcomes. I mean, sometimes they'll have a minor success, you know, a little bit of a success. Sometimes he'll have a minor defeat, and he'll decide to escalate next time instead of just using a fist, maybe use a box cutter. Something of that sort, you know, a little escalation. Sometimes people have major defeats. They get the hell beaten out of them, and they decide, this is not for me, I'm not going to do it, I give up. They can turn to other solutions, like go to the authorities, talk to a teacher. Some kids, the suspicion is that this is the choice point where they get more depressed and end up suiciding. Other people increase the intensity and keep going. You know, again, my hunch is that people in the room have had some of these experiences, that they are able and capable, like many people in our society, to defend themselves and defend people they love, and that they can use serious violence to protect themselves. These would be people with mitigated violent resolutions. But a lot of people stop here. A lot of people in civil society stop here. And the reasons why they stop here, you know, it's against the law to move it beyond that. And also, others of us in our life have a lot of nonviolent coaching. So civil society includes a lot of defensively violent people. You know, people who are willing to protect themselves and their loved ones also are violent professionals, people like our police and soldiers who follow rules that the society has drafted that say these are the reasons why you're allowed to use this force, and these are the reasons, the line at which we want you to stop. But our civil society also includes pacifists. I mean, battered women are a pretty classic example of people who can't even protect themselves for a multitude of reasons, one of which is what we understand to be called learned helplessness over time. In fact, Athens saw learned helplessness as the opposite of violent coaching. But also in our society, we have a smaller group, and we're lucky that it's a small group, of dangerous violent criminals, people who use violence. So stage four is that group of people. And the question is, I mean, sometimes successful violent performances can lead to more sinister outcomes. And the question is, what makes people go on? How do they go from this point where they're willing to be defensively violent, but move into this next stage where they use violence beyond that? Well, there's an interesting thing that happens sometimes to people. And if you think about this 8-year-old that's gone through 8 to 10 years worth of domination by all kinds of people and feels a lot of shame and rage and humiliation about that fact, when they start using violence and they start having successes, their community around them shifts and they get treated differently than they have before. Athens called it social trepidation and violent notoriety. You know, they take on a different aura in their communities. People step back a little bit, you know? They're not quite sure what to do with them. And for some people, that can be intoxicating, really intoxicating, to have that kind of a shift. And there is that mental shift from, if it works so well on a defensive basis, then why don't I use it to get my way? Why don't I just use to get my way? And these people are the ones that Athens and most of us would call dangerous violent criminals, people who are willing to use violence to hurt other people for not reasons of self-defense.
In the course of looking and interviewing violent criminals, Athens also looked at the process they go through when they decide to use violence in a specific instance. And I think it's important to say that they made it clear to him that they did always make a decision about whether or not to use violence. The idea that there's such a thing as impulsive violence, that someone just somehow magically decide suddenly to be violent, was not supported by any of the work that Athens did. Even when the decision seems to be quick or even instantaneous, we often value people who make up their minds quickly, and that's the circumstance that we're talking about. So in this conscious process, Athens was able to break out 4 basic patterns of when people decide to use violence. And of course, there's also that other piece, which is sometimes people decide the circumstances are appropriate to use violence, but then the circumstances change in some way, and they decide at that point, maybe not this time. We saw that a little bit with the novice who's trying to learn to use violence and is only prepared to use it under certain circumstances. Every police officer you'll ever speak with will say to you at some point, people tend not to commit murders in the presence of a uniformed police officer. And that's an example of the kind of circumstance where someone who is prepared to use violence may change their minds. But the way they decide to use violence, Athens found, broke down into physically defensive violence, which is, if you will, the violence of the bar fight. Someone feels threatened, they're frightened by the threat and angered by the threat, and they use violence to respond to that threat. Frustrative is a category that Athens defines when people are trying to get something they want, and someone else, for whatever reason, doesn't want to give it to them. That's rape, that's robbery. And the emotion there, of course, is frustration. Malefic violence, Athens found, was the kind that is classically hate crimes, but occurs often when people decide that someone else is in some way dissing them, in some way disrespecting them. And the emotion there is hatred, quite simply. And then there was this one kind of composite crime that he found, where what had started out as a frustrative situation, maybe someone is robbing someone, he has an instance of someone who's robbing someone, and then this man's partner, the man is gay, the man's partner emerges from the bedroom, this guy is homophobic, this robber, and it makes him angry and he hates gays, and he proceeded to kill the man he was trying to rob. And there the emotion shifts along the way. So, one of the things that I looked into at great length in an essay I wrote for Rolling Stone magazine some years ago was the whole question of so-called media violence, which I came to call mock violence. Because what you see on television, what kids see when they play video games, is not real violence. If you doubt that, just think of the times when you have seen real violence, a bloody car accident, scenes from war, and think of your emotional response compared to the last Western you saw or the last movie you saw that included shootings and so on. They're not the same thing, and it seems that people are able to distinguish them. I put this graph up of the decline in violence computed against sales of computers and video games, just as sort of an illustrative example of the kind of confusion that surrounds this argument. What I did find, sadly, was that some of the most heralded sociological research into this area was close to being fraudulent. In one celebrated example, which when it was discussed in the Senate by the two sociologists who did the work, led to the development of the device that was attached to televisions to allow people to shut out those channels. The actual sample size of this correlational research was three boys who had watched Saturday morning cartoons at the age of 8. This out of 700 or 800 people studied. So, obviously, not even remotely credible, although it turned out to be marginally statistically significant. I think the myth of media violence is one that has emerged for a good reason. We live in a remarkably peaceful society, and many people have never seen real physical violence in their entire lives. When some kid from a nice, seemingly suburban family shoots up a school, the question becomes, where the hell did that come from? And one of the places people turn, seemingly logically enough, but not supported by evidence, is the media that the child has been exposed to. If you trace that back, you can go back to the Victorian era when novels were considered to corrupt the young, or my childhood when comic books were considered to rot our brains. It seems that the latest form of media becomes the bugaboo for those who have a kind of moral panic about media as the latest one comes along. The real source of violence, as I think Athens' work makes clear, is in the socialization of people, often children, often within the family. So, to take us to what we have found in looking beyond Athens' work to try to identify possible interventions that might prevent the complete violent socialization of children or of anyone that can be got at somehow, but particularly children. One of the first and obvious things is it's important to have a model. It's very hard to track down the cause of a disease if you have a pre-formulated idea of what the sources might be. My favorite example is always malaria. Malaria was supposed to be some sort of exudation of gases from the swamp for many centuries. And if you think about it, it makes a certain rough sense because mosquitoes breed in swamps. And if people lived around swamps or mosquito breeding areas, they tended to get malaria if that was a disease of that area. So it's understandable that that idea arose, but the fact is, it's a particular type of mosquito carrying a particular type of parasite that causes malaria. It's very helpful to look at Athens' model as the test and the basis for the methods that might be used to help children find better ways to grow up than being socialized to be violent. So, since it's very difficult to identify in advance, or did I move way beyond where I was? Thank you. Thanks. I must have been pounding on the computer.
You were.
The real problem is getting inside the family, where a great deal of violent socialization takes place in our society. The recent NFL player who switched his child to bloody wounds was quoted as saying, "Can't nobody tell me how to discipline my kids?" And we cherish having a space that isn't politicized completely, the family and within the family, and have reason to want to maintain a degree of privacy from public scrutiny. So the question is, how do we kind of square that circle? So violence becomes, I think, a question of general methods, rather like the ways the cardiologists and others have developed over the years to help people avoid heart disease, not by starting with people who have heart disease, but by giving us all broad guidelines and treatments and advice and methods that will help us prevent ever developing heart disease. So similarly, we've looked for systems that help families actually not get started with using violence on children. One that we found was a nurse family partnership developed by a Denver physician named David Olds, where public health nurses or trained non-professionals went into families for an hour a month, starting when a woman was pregnant with her first child, to help them learn how to take care of their children. The direct point was not to say, don't beat your children. It was rather, these are ways to help your child thrive. And among them, when perhaps a mother who had been raised with physical discipline took a child that was crying and spanked it or hit it, the nurse could simply say, wait, maybe there's something the child needs. Let's see, maybe they're not simply being willful, this six-month-old baby. Let's find out what its problem is. Ah, it needs its diapers changed. Ah, it's hungry. And thereby, in a 15-year follow-up, 56% fewer doctor and hospital visits due to childhood injuries up to age two. 48% lower incidence of child abuse and neglect. Something so simple. And that program evidently has now been replicated in many states across the United States. So there's one. But after the program ended, this one ended at age 2. I found others that ended around age 4 or 5. The old kind of method of raising children tended to recur within some vulnerable families. So then how do you get into the older family? Addison County, Vermont, in 1980, developed a network of parent-child center in one county in Vermont that was a comprehensive program. Included the home visits, particularly in Vermont, where people tend to be scattered across the land and don't necessarily all live in cities. A linked network of service providers, meaning all the disparate services that states and counties offer to families in need, were all pulled together with representatives in the community center setting so that there was kind of a one-stop shopping and an easy referral to these different programs. And then all of the related core services that you see listed on the point. Because the 16 centers today refers to the fact that the program was so successful that it was replicated in every county in Vermont. A similar center was developed in every county in Vermont. It was assessed on a regular basis by the University of Vermont to make sure that the programs were working. There was constant feedback with the people who were running the programs and the researchers so that they evolved these programs as they went along. And their outcomes included teenage pregnancy rate dropped down to something like 5% of what it had been before. Very few juveniles involved with the courts, and you can read the rest. All this from what was basically, I mean, this is kind of a variation on It Takes a Village. What I see these programs as doing is basically replicating what Athens calls a civil community in small, in intensified form for whatever community they're serving. So that whether or not their political communities do this work, these programs fill in and supplement and educate and give people, even in the case of the community centers, give kids who are in situations of abuse a place to go. As I remember vividly as a boy, when my stepmother was beating on us, going to the library. Thank God there were books in the library. It's a place to be safe. They followed the research through with a second generation, and they found that the effects have replicated down through these families, as you can see on this list. And I highlighted the last one on the list because that speaks specifically to the question of violent socialization. These programs, of course, cover much more territory than only the question of children being violently dominated by others. They cover all the health aspects and social aspects, pregnancy and so on. But the lack of interaction with the legal system suggests that they are also effective in reducing the levels of violent socialization.
No, you should stay here. The anti-bullying programs are an interesting thing to look at. In terms of, this was a big study with about 7,000 kids in 195 schools nationwide. And it's interesting when you look at the outcomes research on the anti-bullying programs. They do and they don't work. And they do work for some reasons that weren't anticipated, and they don't work in ways that they'd hoped. And that is that when the programs focus on the bully or on the victims, they're not as successful as when the programs focus on the larger issue. And that is that the schools need a clear policy, the school districts need a clear policy, the teachers need to be fully informed about that policy, they need to be engaged in the school in implementing that policy, the parents need to be supportive of the kids. In fact, there was a study just in the New York Times, I saw a piece about it, I haven't seen the full study yet, in the Times, I think it was yesterday, that kids who have dinner with their families are less likely to be bullied. So again, it's support for this whole structural model, that the structure really makes a big difference if the kids have some place to go to and if everybody knows what the rules are and they're being reinforced, it makes a big difference. But you gotta have a model. I mean, that's one point that we've come back to here again and again. You know, I ran a group, I did some work in prison, in the state intake jail in a state back east, and in a medium security prison, and I ran a group for angry men in so-called anger management, because that's the way I could get the group done. But one guy in the group came back after like the second session, and I was teaching these guys the model. I mean, any of us, our experiences, if you want to change, you got to understand why you do what you do and how you came to do what you do. You got to understand it. We're not automatons. We don't just change. So these guys, I'm talking to them about the model. And this guy comes back, and he was one of the guys that I was the least impressed by. And he raises his hand first at the beginning of the group. He's got his hand up, and the initial part of the group was always anything resonate during the past week, you know, anything you want to talk about. He wanted to talk. He'd been talking to his five-year-old on the phone, and his five-year-old was beaten on his toys, and it clicked for this guy that he had influenced his child. And he spent about 3-5 minutes in a group with 15 other violent guys in a prison where you don't let your guard down, you don't let people know what's going on in your life. He was so vulnerable for those 5 minutes, when he talked about how it was impacting his kid, and what he didn't want for his kid was for his kid to have the life he led. And I found that again and again and again. If there was a place with those guys who had years and decades of experience in using violence and maybe couldn't change themselves, you know, maybe were only aging out of it because they got older, it really mattered to them about their children, and they all had kids. The other thing about it is the potential for reversing violent socialization. And you know, we do have a natural model, and that is most criminal activity is committed by 15 to 30 year olds. People get a little bit older, they age out of all kinds of crime. And maybe part of it is that they start to get a stake in the world. Richard and I had the occasion to meet a man when we lived back east, a small businessman, and it turns out he had a violent history. He, from young on, he was a petty criminal, graduating to robberies and burglaries. He told us one time about his partner in crime. His partner held out some of the loot, and so he kneecapped him. He shot him in the knees, his partner.
He was about 14 or 15 years old when right. He did that.
Right. So incredibly violent guy. And now here he is, a businessman with a business, and you know, he does all kinds of things. He told us a story one day about how he had this subcontractor who was ripping him off, and he knew he was ripping him off. Oh, the reason why this guy changed into his businessman, he met his wife. And his wife said, "It's either your guys or it's me. You know, which path do you want to go?" And he had just spent the weekend in jail for the first time, and he picked his wife. So here he is, fast forward 20, 30 years later, he's running this business, and he said he's got this contractor, and all night long he was awake, all night long, because he knew in the old days he would have taken a baseball back to that guy, and the guy would have done what he wanted him to do. So that's the other secret about this.
But he no longer used violence, right. So he couldn't go that route.
But that's the other secret, is it works. It works. If we don't protect people, if we don't protect kids, if we don't give them the mechanisms to protect themselves, then, you know, people got to do their business.
So that's the model. That's what we've learned. That's the work Athens has done. I think of all the challenges that still exist for reducing violent socialization, penetrating the barrier of the family is probably the most resistant. And I'm sure that's because it's at the heart of our feeling that we need some protection from the state, if you will. We need some space of privacy. As Robert Oppenheimer once said, you need a certain amount of privacy to make mistakes and be able to move on from them. So how you do that, I think some of the programs that we've identified point in the right direction. The one thing that no one has yet devised, if there's anyone here who'd like a really major life project, this is one, and that is reversing violent socialization in people who are already violent. That would be a great boon to humankind for sure, but preventing it perhaps even more so. Thank you.
Thank you.
So we have time to take some questions. Yes.
Have you found any forms of violence that don't fit your model? I'm thinking, for example, of fetal alcohol syndrome.
Can you repeat the question?
I will repeat the question. The question is, have we found any forms of violence that don't fit the model? And I think the answer that I have to give is no. When people are so damaged by mental illness or physical illness or inherited conditions, they don't become violent the same way, and they don't use violence that way. So, you know, I wanted to look at some circumstance that was sufficiently different from Lonnie's studies to see if I could credibly test the model. And I looked at the SS Einsatzgruppen. These were the SS men who were trained, to follow the Wehrmacht into the Soviet Union in the summer of 1941 and murder Jews by shooting them into killing pits all over Eastern Europe. Almost 1.5 million Jews were shot to death by the SS Einsatzgruppen and local police forces before the invention of the death camps. If any group of people would be different from the petty criminals and murderers in American prisons, it seemed to me these might be. But there was no question whatsoever when I looked into their training and the kind of things they were ordered to do, the conflicts they felt when the orders extended beyond what they could construe to be defensive violence. They started out killing only male Jews of military age, which they could rationalize as somehow being guerrillas or saboteurs or even members of some mystical military. But when in the summer of 41, Hitler thought he was going to destroy the Soviet Union by Christmas time, the order went out to start killing women and children, and the SS Einsatzgruppen, some of them, started breaking down because that extended beyond their sense and became severely traumatic. Some of them, the ones that really worried Himmler the most, started enjoying the killing. Now they became fully malefic, and murder became a form of self-expression. And they would volunteer to go even when they were off duty, or they would try to go out at night on their own. And those disturbed Himmler so much, who wanted his men to kill out of duty, but not out of pleasure. He thought that was bestial, that he told his assistants, we've got to find some other way to do this. And the way they found, not because it was more efficient, but because it involved fewer of his men actually directly confronting this kind of killing, was the gas chambers. So it really was a revelation to me, and I hope to others, about the actual evolution of this kind of mass killing. Mass killing was already going on, but it was one-to-one. People were being herded into pits and shot to death all day by men soldiers. These men, for me, really, really confirmed the model in a dramatic way. And I wrote a book about that called Why They called Masters of Death, if you can bear to read it.
Mm-hmm, please.
I wish I could agree with you, but people who are violent
need to repeat.
The question is, restoring compassion in people should reduce their levels of violence, and perhaps that's true. But I would just point out that people who are violent are compassionate about the people they value. It's very common in families, as some of you know very well, for a father who beats his sons never to touch his daughters and to value them differently. I think of something I noticed recently. Shakespeare's Globe Theater was built right next door to an almost identical round open roof theater that was devoted to bear baiting, which means basically torturing bears. And the audiences for Lear and Romeo and Juliet and all of these deep and wonderful and rich human stories were the same audiences. So it depends very much on context and whom you value. And people who are violent don't not value anybody. They simply have rules that they follow as to when they can use violence and when they cannot.
There is an aspect of compassion, I think, that we could all use a lot more of, and that is caring about other people's children. You know, the fact that we protect children in some communities and not in communities, and that we pass judgment on children in other communities. I mean, we need to be responsible for protecting children from brutalization. Because if people aren't brutalized, we interrupt the first stage of this process, and you can't go any farther with it. So if we had a responsible, compassionate approach to all the children's, I think that could go a long way in making a difference in that not intervening, but preventing.
I noticed when you addressed the role of the media, you mentioned cartoons, comic strips, and computer games. But I'm of a certain age, and I recall that the American motion picture industry had an enormous role in establishing acceptable codes for violence. And I can barely think of a Saturday morning at the double feature where John Wayne or somebody was not punching somebody, and it seemed to me that in 90% of the films I saw through my boyhood and my adolescence were messages about the role of violence, the utility of violence, even in High Noon, the abstention from violence. Do you or do Professor Athens ever consider that the motion picture industry's responsibility in this regard?
You know, there's a function for these dramas that go back all through human history of heroes and villains. And the function that one particular sociologist who's looked at so-called media violence argues is the basis for it, is to teach particularly young men what the rules are. When violence is, when you can be a hero, what's good? what's bad and what's in between. And although we sometimes think it gets stretched almost out of total recognition in some films, in some video games, nevertheless, the function is really, he argues, rather benevolent, paradoxical as that seems, where while when you think about what violent socialization describes in the way children are mistreated, that's a totally different world and one that is so much more vivid. I mean, the key to becoming violent, ultimately, as Ginger made clear, is in learning to use violence yourself. You don't learn to use violence by watching a movie or watching television or playing a video game. You learn by taking a life-threatening risk of attacking someone else mm-hmm. whom you know is credibly threatening you in a serious way. That's a totally different order of experience, as anyone who's been in a fight must be aware. So there are lots of functions for these great dramas all the way through literature and film and the stage and so forth. But learning to kill people is probably not one of them.
Some people from the back, sir, right on the aisle.
Could you please comment on the role of drugs and alcohol use?
Drugs and alcohol use, comment on those. Alcohol, certainly, I mentioned earlier, alcohol lowers people's inhibitions and allows them oftentimes to act more quickly in ways they might act, and drugs in the same way. But there's a question about why some people who use substances are violent and other people who use substances aren't violent. So again, it comes back to the exposure to this model. You know, that's the underlying thing that's in common 100% of the time, is learning this at least 3 to 4 stage process in how to use violence. But drugs, substances, if someone is violent, it can make them quicker to act.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering if you know of some programs in which, because in which there's been a constructive way to talk with parents who aren't trigger happy or won't lock up their guns, or you know, who are already very frightened to not have their guns available.
You know, in many states, pediatricians aren't even allowed to ask whether there's a gun in the home. So it's a logical place for that discussion to start, for at least a pediatrician to be assessing if there's a gun in the home. It's a very good question, and it's a big problem. You know, one thing that I don't think I mentioned earlier, but about that process that it takes for a novice to get big enough and strong enough and courageous enough to make that first violent act, guns are the great equalizer. I mean, a gun can make you as big as you need to be, and you don't even need to get up close to that big guy. So you just pull the trigger.
Interestingly, in our society, if you extract from the homicide rate of 4.7 the homicides committed with weapons, with guns, we're still about twice as homicidal as Western Europe. There are other aspects of our culture, probably relating to a continuing belief that there are certain kinds of threats and insults that we have the right to personally address. I mean, disrespect or whatever you want to call it, that is more virulent in America still. Then it's interesting that the most violent quarter of the United States is the South, where I think traditions of, you know, when the king started centralizing control over violence in the 16th century, they made dueling an act of treason against the king. It wasn't simply your settling a dispute with the guy who had thrown down the glove or slapped you with the glove. You were also, in effect, disrespecting the king of the country. I think that speaks to exactly an understanding that if you're going to control violence, you really can't have a lot of exceptions where private violence is still allowed. For many years, husbands could get away with killing their wives if they found them in bed with the neighbor and so forth. And those things have slowly changed. And as they've changed, our violence levels have gone down and still are. There's also an interesting relationship, inverse correlation between reducing homicide and increasing suicide, as if somehow people who might use violence against others find that the only solution to their problem is to use it against themselves. So interesting the way these things work within a society, but the trend has been remarkably toward reducing violence in large measure.
Someone over here, sir, all the way back. Uh-huh. I'm not sure I heard the last half of that. Repeat it out loud, too.
I had trouble hearing you. I'm sorry. Say it a little louder.
I'm curious whether the three stages of brutalization could be affected by the violations of personal boundaries
that
aren't strictly violence or rely on threats of violence, but have a similar effect. Emotional abuse.
I think Athens' model, as he based it, as he describes it, is pretty clear. That the threat has to be basically physical.
Yes.
It may be verbal.
Or credible.
But it isn't just, you're stupid.
Yeah.
It's also, I'll beat the shit out of you if you don't shut up.
Yeah.
Right? So, yes.
Hi, we very much enjoyed this. I'm very impressed that Santa Fe has so many people interested in this.
Yeah.
It is cold.
I've studied this area in the area of Indians and Eskimos, and I just want to make a few quick points. One is that substance abuse is often timeout behavior, as Edgerton and McAndrews Edgerton said. That is to say, within a society that's very attuned to aggression as a prelude to violence, it will react with aggression, anticipating violence when there is aggressive behavior. A drunk person is often perceived as being temporarily mentally ill. It's timeout behavior, and what they do while they're intoxicated won't count against the sober person.
Mm.
Another thing is, I think that it's much more difficult, the relationship between aggression and violence. That's a tricky conundrum right there. And my last point is, if you are true to this violent socialization model, I would encourage you as professionals to try to find a way to induce it into the recruitment of police and the maintenance of police, because in this situation, those attuned to violence and who seek out legitimate violence are very likely to become police.
Well, I mean, the fact is police are a self-selected group.
Yeah.
Unlike, let's say, draftees, police already presumably are at least partly violently socialized before they arrive to sign up. The problem with police, as with military, is to somehow find a way to keep them at the defensively violent level within the rules rather than spilling over into violence that we call atrocities and so forth. That's become much more difficult with our military because modern weapons are so incredibly destructive compared to the weapons of yore. And it's so much harder, evidently, these days to distinguish between non-combatants and combatants.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.